Okay, this is Dave Gibbons, and this is my walkthrough for the ImagineFX Rorschach cover. Here's the finished thing, more or less, as it appears on the cover. So I'll step back in time, go back to the very beginning, and try and show you how I got there. Okay, this is the very rough that I originally agreed with the art editor. As you can see, we went for a very straightforward, straight on, symmetrical headshot of Rorschach. I think he's the character that most people associate with Watchmen, and you know, he's got a really interesting kind of abstract design on his face, which hopefully is quite arresting. This was done very quickly in Photoshop, just in grayscale, just to give an idea of how everything might work. Here's the same rough placed into Manga Studio, which is a very useful piece of kit for doing the equivalent of comic book work in. It's got some wonderful penciling tools and inking tools. It also has a very nice perspective feature that you can use to quickly establish perspective, and you can draw lines which radiate from a point. And it's also got another interesting little feature or two, one of which I'll show you in a minute. So this is me beginning to set up the perspective on the brick wall. This is again in Manga Studio. This is a tracing that I did over the rough, just to get a slightly cleaned up and better proportioned version of it. As you can see, still very loose, and this is drawn with a Manga Studio pencil tool, which I think you'll agree looks very like a real pencil. Here it is laid over the rough, and on the left of the image you can see that I've started to mark out more accurately the size of the bricks, so that I can draw them easily. This is using a tool that's in Manga Studio, which is a symmetry tool, whereby you can draw symmetrically about an axis. So in other words, with this I only had to draw the left hand side of Rorschach's hat, and it immediately drew for me the right hand side. Very useful in symmetrical situations. So here's the entire thing inked in. This isn't a final ink drawing, but it's a sort of a hard line guide. Again, you know, the blot and everything are symmetrical, because they truly are. I'm working a bit more on the brick walls here. Although we only see a little bit of the brick wall on the right, I wanted to make sure that it fitted with the one on the left. And that's quite a simple thing if you're drawing symmetrically, or if you merely just get one half and flip it over to the other side. Also here you can see the poster on the wall that again I drew very quickly in Manga Studio, and then did a perspective transform on. All this kind of work is very mechanical, but it's really necessary if you want to get background elements to look convincing. You know, it's always worth a bit of preparation here, particularly if you're using software which very easily enables you to you know, get certain effects. Now, apart from being drawn in Manga Studio, this was also drawn on my other new toy, which is a Wacom Cintiq tablet, which is a screen where you actually draw on the image with a pressure sensitive pen. Now, because of the size of the Cintiq tablet and the fact that it will rotate to any orientation, I actually turn it so it's in portrait rather than landscape format. And then it's exactly the same as drawing on a piece of illustration board, exactly the same size, and it gives exactly the same sensation. So that's very useful. Here I'm just penciling freehand. I've already got the symmetrical sketch underneath, but it would be too much to do the pencil sketch symmetrically as well. It would look far too mechanical. So I'm just using this as a guide. Here it is a little more developed. Again, I've just penciled fairly loosely away at it. You can zoom in to do details, but generally with a pencil drawing, it's probably best if you keep more or less at the same scale and don't get too lost in details at this stage. And this is the whole thing penciled out. Again, the straight line elements of the buildings in the background I've only roughed in because I know that I can clean those up very easily when I come to ink them. So that's the finished pencil stage. This is the beginnings of the inking, which is done on a separate layer in Manga Studio. I've knocked the opacity of the pencils back a bit, I think, although I may have actually brought them forward here for the sake of clarity. And I'm just inking away as I normally would. Again, the fact that you can rotate the working surface mimics what you would do if you were drawing in a conventional way. And of course, the ability to quickly just drop in solid blacks is a great help. This is working on the buildings in the background, which again, you can use the straight line tool in Manga Studio. And again, you don't have to worry about going over the lines because you can correct them very easily. Oh yeah, I could have done the lettering on the poster, you know, by distorting some typeset words, four more years. But I actually did it in the way that I did all the lettering when I did Watchmen, which was to do it by hand. And the easy way to do that is to rule out the top and bottom lines and then fill in the letters in between them and then erase the top and bottom lines where you don't need them. So that helps to keep everything nicely lined up. This is pretty much the final thing in Manga Studio. Again, you know, probably indistinguishable from what I would have done had I been drawing it with conventional materials on a piece of illustration board. Okay, now we're in Photoshop, where I've turned the black and white Manga Studio image into a CMYK document, and it looks like I'm going through here doing some corrections. It's useful to have the line, the black line, in a separate channel. It's always useful if you have to make a selection, as we'll see a bit later. It's useful if you want to turn the black line into a different colour. And it's always a good standby in case everything goes terribly wrong. This is putting a separate layer in for the colour. The line layer floats on top of the colour layer. I'm actually colouring using layers rather than channels, which was the old way to do it. Here I've made the white areas of the line channel transparent. You can just set it to multiply mode, but if you want to change the colours of lines, it's useful to do it like this. Okay, this is the first stage in doing the flat colours, and anything that I do in colour with line, I always have a flat version of it. It's always a good idea to work from large to small. As you can see here, I've covered the whole image area with a sort of a darkish, middle-ish tone. Here I'm separating out the next big element, which is the figure of Rorschach. Again, I've done the whole thing in one colour. This makes it very easy, as you can see here, when I've separated out the headband, that with the lasso tool, which is what you use to do these flats, you can click round the hat band, but you don't have to worry about selecting the edge of it again, because you can go beyond that into the background colour and then fill the colour in, not by using option delete, but by clicking with the paint bucket, which will only fill in the colour that you've got on your, as it were, foreground object. So that saves selecting edges twice, and that can be a real time saver. This is pretty much the whole thing done in flats. Again, you know, these are representative of the final colours. They're not exactly the final colours. They're really, as much as anything, a way of being able to select the areas to render. Oh, in between the last image and this one, I read in an email from Paul Teisel, the art editor of ImagineFX, that it was raining in this image, and I hadn't accounted for that. So, as you can see, I've quickly added some rain. Okay, now once I've got the flat colour in, I copy the whole colour layer and I then paste it into a channel. This gives you a channel I've called flats, which means that at any point you can go back to that channel with the magic wand tool and select any area. So even after you've rendered an area, you can still get back to the whole flat area. And that can be a lifesaver. Okay, here we are. I've started to do some rendering on it. This is an early pass to the rendering, which I think I later discarded. Again, if you don't like the rendering, you can easily just fill it with flat colour again. This is showing what's known in the trade as a colour hold, which is basically where you turn an area of black line work into coloured line work. Very useful for knocking a background back. The way you do that is to use your line channel to select the line layer and delete the areas which you don't want, and then to fill those areas with the colour of your choice. Again, if you select preserve transparency on the layer, you can do it without recourse to the channel, but it's a slightly easier way of making sure you only select exactly the area that you want to change. Here I'm actually removing the line work because I thought the graffiti on the wall worked better without a key line. You can see I've already put a gradient on the background to try and get some sense of dimension to it. Here, this is the gradient going on the backgrounds, on the background walls, and as you can see, I've dragged out a gradient from the centre of the moon, and I've also put a little bit of blur around the edge of the moon. Actually, it's a feathered selection that I filled just to make the moon look distant, as if through a damp sky. This is now rendering on top of the colour layer. Although sometimes I like to render straight on the colour layer, it can be useful to have a couple of layers, one set to multiply and one set to screen. And you can use the multiply layer to darken, and you can use the screen layer to lighten. And if you always lighten with the same colour and always darken with its own same colour, you can give a sense of consistency to the lighting throughout the scene. And you want to set your brush or your airbrush or your pencil at a fairly low opacity so that you can actually build up the lights and darks on it. Okay, this is showing the thing fairly well developed along now. I haven't really done much on the poster in the background or the scarf, but the coat is pretty well rendered, and the bricks have had some highlights and shadow applied to them. It's coming a bit closer to show you a brush that I've used to add a bit of dirt and a bit of texture to it. Not sure where I got this brush from. It was probably off an ImagineFX DVD, but it's basically a texture brush that you can use again on one of the lighten, rather screen or multiply layers, just to add a bit of texture and interest to it. Here again, you're starting to get that you can see this texture on the wall at the back. The hat's rendered. The walls have been worked on a little bit more. Again, they're supposed to be background elements, so they don't need to be too obtrusive. Just to have the feeling of light spilling across them is enough. Here I'm adjusting the hue and saturation of, I think it's probably of the mask, although I'm not absolutely sure about that, but whichever area it is anyway, that's quite a useful way to kind of globally adjust elements in it. Again, you can see there's some grunge put over Rorschach's grubby scarf. Here, this is I think probably the finished image. This has got a frame on a layer which just shows me where the sort of trim of the cover will be. And as you can see, I've got some layers here for the rain. We've got the rain that I drew in line. Then we've got a layer called Tiny Rain, which is which I made by putting some random dots on a layer and then using motion blur. The more tiny rain is the same again, but smaller. And again, messing around with the hue, saturation and so on. And at this point, I've just done it all over the whole image, and I'll later, using the flats channel, delete the rain that shouldn't be, the small little bits of rain that shouldn't be in front of Rorschach, which I think is in fact what this screenshot shows. This is the selection around Rorschach, and the final stage where I'm starting to clean everything up. So that is the end of the walkthrough. I hope that's been of interest. Thanks a lot. Bye.